Hey guys, it's your girl Koryn Hawthorne, and I am here with the Atlanta Voice newspaper.
Hey you guys, I'm Krystal Ketcham with the Atlanta Voice, and I'm sitting here with amazing, talented, young Koryn Hawthorne.
Yes.
How are you today?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good. Now, I love your voice. It's amazing. It's different. So who was the first person to put the mic in your hand?
Well, I was the first person. Nobody had to put a mic in my hand. My first mic was a brush, and I picked it up myself. But music has always been something that I just gravitated to naturally. So, yeah.
Do you come from a family
of singers?
Yes.
Yeah, actually, yes. My dad's side, they're full of singers. My church, my home church, is my family's church, and all my cousins are like the lead worship. They're full of singers. So, yeah, it's definitely in the genes.
Okay, so you grew up in Abbeville, Louisiana.
Yes, ma'am.
What was that like?
Cool. Not really that much happening there. It's a super small town. Louisiana has great culture and influence, especially for music. There are a lot of good music culture in Louisiana, but it's a small town. So, you know, I went to a private school, really, really, really sheltered, grew up in church. But music was everything for me. That was like my outlet to actually get out and experience.
So did your parents, growing up, did your parents monitor the type of music you listen to? I'm like, oh, you can't listen to that R&B?
No.
My
mom
to?
Was very open. She knew I loved music, so I listened to everything. I was an old soul, so I loved Etta James, James Brown, Michael Jackson, girl, yes.
Okay.
Mary J. Blige, too. I grew up listening to that. So, no, she knew that I loved it, so, you know, she was always very... Here, go listen to this. So it was good.
So, growing up in Louisiana, what kind of effect does that have on your music and your sound?
I don't really think that Louisiana kind of influences my sound. I don't know. Maybe it does. I personally never really. It probably does. Shout out Louisiana folk. It probably does. I don't know. I just think that they have very strong jazz influences.
Okay.
And soul, of course. So maybe because I'm an old soul, I don't know, girl. I never really thought about that.
So I read you worked at Little Caesars.
Mm-hmm.
So how does somebody working at Little Caesars goes to be on The Voice? Explain that.
God, because you know what? I worked at Little Caesars when I was 16. I was still in high school, and my mom and my dad made me get it because they wanted to teach me responsibility. So shout out to them. But
the worst place to work, fast food.
You know what? No, shout out to Little Caesars. You guys know that I love y'all so much. They've been so supportive of everything. But it was just to teach me responsibility. But I've been singing since I was 2. So, music was definitely always the main goal. And they knew whenever I went out to audition for The Voice, they were super supportive. They let me take off all those days. So, yeah. And then it took off from there. I never even put in, we were talking about this, I never put in my notice. I didn't put in a 2 weeks notice, but yeah.
Oh, you don't need to, because your career is definitely going up.
Thank you.
Just to set the scene for you. So you're on stage in front of all these people, and all the judges have their backs turned to you. What was going through your mind? Who did you want to hit that buzzer?
I think I wanted Pharrell for sure to hit it. I wanted all of them to turn because, you know, I guess for the goal for The Voice, you want a 4-chair, but clearly that doesn't matter. But, I wanted Pharrell to turn. I thought that I was going to choose him in the beginning. Him and Christina turned for me. And I chose Christina in The Blinds, actually. She just said she said the right stuff in the moment. I'm all about in the moment, and she spoke to my heart in that moment. But God had a plan. Ultimately, I feel like it was all purposed, and I ended up getting stolen to Pharrell's team, and it was great.
So once your mom found out you chose Christina, she was like,
no, girl. They was happy that we were happy that we were just even on the show, super thankful for the opportunity. Of course, she was like, what happened? Like, I thought you were, but I just told her, she said, and she understood, but they're super supportive. I think that we were all just happy that we even got the opportunity to move forward, so.
Now, your song selection throughout the show was amazing. Like, your start-out song was amazing. Why that song? And then you chose Woman's World. Why?
Man's World. It was a Man's World by James Brown. I did that one for the finale. My first song that I chose was How Great Thou Art. I grew up watching reality TV singing shows, and I did a lot of competitions, too. So, I was definitely prepared for it. Mm-hmm. I had the mind for it. I knew that I had to have great song choices every week. But I think even with the conversation with Pharrell on the show was just that we always wanted to choose something that meant something on the inside and something that I could relate to and feel, because ultimately I took my position, even being on The Voice, very seriously because I wanted to inspire as much people through my journey there. But Man's World was, I love James Brown. I love him. You are really known, so I love it. I love James Brown, so I had to do it. Yeah. It's a man's world.
So speaking of Pharrell, what was it like to sit down with this man? Not many people get this opportunity, so what's the best advice he ever gave to you? Or something that really stuck with you?
Don't read the comments and to be myself. And I think that sounds cliche when you say be yourself, but he understood. Like, Pharrell is such a down-to-earth person, and I've been through some things before The Voice where I auditioned for other shows, and because I sung gospel or, proclaimed my faith, they kind of was like, hey, you should stay away from that. And he understood that, and we didn't even have to really talk about it that much, but he always encouraged me, Koryn, be yourself. Don't let nobody change you. You need to stay exactly how you are, and don't read the comments.
So speaking of gospel music, do you think being labeled as a gospel artist and just having a lot of gospel selections, that would kind of change the trajectory of your career? Like, some things are limited to you?
I think that that's happened. Mm-hmm. I think that people try to put limits on gospel music. But personally, I don't think like that. I'm not going to allow myself to think like that. I created the song. We have the song Won't You Do It, which you said you love. And I just think that this year, God is proving just in this season that he has no limits. So I serve a big God. I'm not going to let anybody try to. It's not y'all that's making it happen. It is him. So he's limitless. And I think that that's just my mindset. I don't think that nothing will be withheld from
God. I love that. You know? I love that. So speaking of your single Won't He Do It, it was featured on Greenleaf. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. Mm-hmm. How'd you feel about that?
Blessed opportunity. Whenever I heard the song initially, I just was like, okay, this is such a great song, but how can I get it? Girl, shout out to Makeba, Grammy Award winning writer. So shout out to her. She wrote the song. I knew that I was gonna be on Greenleaf. They wanted me to do a song for the soundtrack. I just didn't know which one, and they played me that song. And my goal was to just make it personal so okay. I could feel it and people could feel it, because y'all know that's the goal. And I think that we did that. I never thought about the song going past Greenleaf.
So do you write?
Yeah, I do. Yes, I write.
So on your...
my EP.
Your EP. Mm-hmm. How much of that did you actually...
A lot. Won't You Do It is the only song from the EP that I didn't write on. So
where do you get the inspiration?
I think in just... the moment. Like, I'm super in the moment person. When we go in the studio, whatever God is saying in that moment, you know, that's the most important thing. And of course, from life experiences and stuff like that, but yeah.
So your EP was released in August. We want to know, when's the album coming out, and is Pharrell helping you with this?
Album's coming out in the summer. He might, you never know what could happen. We're working on it now, so you never know.
Any features we should know?
You never know.
So what's next for you?
What's next for me? Of course, the album, of course, and just elevation. I'm praying for God to continue to do this work that he has for me. I don't know what's up ahead. None of us does, but I think that this is a great season, like we talked about earlier, for God. Just, we're not putting any limits on God, so that could be with anything. Hopefully more TV and film, Greenleaf season 3. So you guys need to be looking out for that. You never know, touring shows, so I think it's going to be a great year. I'm excited.
So you're 20 now, but where would you like to be at 25? Where do you see yourself at 25?
I don't know. Established artist, successful, impacting lives for sure. I just think that I want to be able to have created a name for myself and be exactly where God wants me to be. That's the most important thing to me. I'm not even trying to sound cliche. I just want to do whatever God wants for me to do. And if I'm where he wants me to be, then goals. I don't have nothing to worry about.
So, the person you are today, what would you show your 13-year-old self?
What would I tell my...
Trying to get in the music game and just work.
Okay, so like other people. So, I think that if you have a gift and you're passionate about something, whatever that is, you definitely have to work hard at it. You have to put a lot of effort into just perfecting whatever that thing is that you like to do. And ultimately, for me, how it works for me was I gave my gift back to God. God gave you whatever that, it doesn't matter, it doesn't even have to be in the music industry or whatever. Whatever you're good at, God gave you that gift. So I think what worked for me was I honestly just gave it back to him and allowed him to guide it. And you don't have to worry about anything if you give it back to God. If God plans your life, then what you have, you don't got to worry about nothing. So yes, you guys just work hard and trust the process.
You're so spiritual. You're so young. So where does this come from? Like,
girl, born and raised in church. God has never been, he's common. Like I've never had a moment where God was not in my life. So it naturally comes. But I think a lot of church kids, if I'm talking about this situation, if any church kids are watching, they try to run away from that. But I just want to encourage you guys, don't run away from it. God placed us where we were for a reason, and I embrace it. I think that God has proven to me that he has a plan for my life, and it's good for me. The plan is good, and there's a scripture, my favorite scripture, Jeremiah 29:11, that says God gives us hope in a future. He's not to harm us or, you know, do us wrong. And I think that just encourages me any day. So I don't know who that was for, but I'm here to let you know that in God, all things are possible and he has a plan for you. So trust that. I don't know why today, but I don't mean to be preachy, but I'm sorry.
So for everyone out there who hasn't heard your song, we're hoping you can give us a little snippet.
Oh, Lord.
Just a little snippet.
Won't he do it? He said he would. Fight your battles for you. They gon' wonder how you sleep at night. Won't he do it? I yes, he will. If anybody tell you something different, you know that's a lie.
You are amazing, girl.
Thank you, girl.
Well, thank you for having me.
This is good. Thank you.
Thank you for watching
me. Ain't nobody stopping my shine. They try to break me, try to take me out, but I got Jesus